Hi, good evening, good morning, wherever you are. Welcome to The 6-Inch Show, episode 59. This show is a kind of unusual-ish show, both Matt and I. This is Matt here, if you've never watched the show. Love Hasbro, particularly 6-Inch figures, Marvel Legends, Star Wars, The Black Series, G.I. Joe, and more. And this week we had an opportunity to sit down with Hasbro in New York, Patrick and Eric, and a couple of the people from Hasbro PR. And a couple of other fan sites as well, and we put some questions to them. So that's probably the bulk of the show we're going to go through. That not a great deal to reveal, but there's a few interesting things, I think, to talk about. We've got a couple of things that went live since we last spoke. And the fan vote, as of the time of doing this show, is still open. So you can vote in Matt's poll, you can vote my poll. You can then go back and vote in each other's because all the votes count, and we'll talk about that too. I think that's pretty much it. I didn't think I missed anything, but we'll dive into the last episode's comments very quickly, just skim through some of them. Last time we were talking about a lot of this stuff had just gone live that we'd found out about it. The fan vote particularly. People are still talking about Cody and Qui-Gon because we kind of mentioned don't kind of waste your vote on Cody, as you quite rightly said, Matt, that he's, you know, they're not going to suddenly make a face for him. Qui-Gon's a good one.
Qui-Gon's a good one. The thing that keeps popping up on my page, and I'm somewhat responsible because I shared a repaint that somebody did of Slave Leia or Hutt Slayer, or whatever you want to call her these days. And there's this ongoing, that in my opinion is this ongoing myth that Disney said they would never make Slave Leia again. And I've gone back, people have been quoting it to me and they've been throwing the article at me, and the article is a Screen Crush article from however many years ago where a Marvel Comics writer said he believed Disney and Lucasfilm would not go ahead with it in the current climate, blah 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 blah. And Screen Crush, in, and he even quotes, this is my opinion.
Yeah.
And Crush then says at the end of that article, we have reached out to Lucasfilm and Disney for comment, and they've given no comment. So everybody, it might be true, but for everybody who keeps responding saying Disney and Lucasfilm have said they will never make another Slave Leia property, it's like, show me the proof. They're very, very direct in their quoting, and maybe they won't, and maybe it's an opinion thing, but in my opinion, there is no fact to it. And we weren't told to remove her from the vote or consideration, because in the past we're being told, I think on one of the vintage collection votes, don't bother with the twin sisters.
Yeah.
That one's not happening. Yeah. And they put it straight out there. It's not happening, kind of thing. So well, look, it could be true, but at the same time, who knows? I'm just putting it out there. It was never confirmed as fact, but it gets quoted back as fact.
Yeah.
Nonstop on my page. It's like, that's a fact. Disney will never do it. It's like, Disney said they'd never do it again. It's like, where? Where did they say it?
That guy that caused all the noise about this, what an a-hole he was with his, you know, it's disgusting. Oh my God. Anyway, let's not get into that. Yes. I mean,
because she's very popular in my votes.
She ditto. And at the end of the day, all they need to do is just call it Leia Organa, bracket Jabba's Palace.
Yeah.
But then I think because the figure's still in the sleeve garb, anyway, let's not go there. People were talking about Zeb, and they're talking about all the characters they could add into the vote. People are looking for Stormtroopers. Greedo in the archive line, that's another good one, but it's not quite taking advantage of the facial scan. And it was a great figure to begin with. Other comments are not so nice. Well, actually, they're not too negative about Hasbro, but they're... they're actually pretty positive about Hasbro. I'll let you read them. Episode 58 comments, pretty much. Biker Scout. What's Boba Fett? Good. Everybody wants these new Stormtroopers. Well, mostly, anyway. What else did we have? Kenneth Corelli Jr. Yet again, every show. Thank you, buddy. A Watto figure. Okay. not quite one in the archive line, but a world figure would be interesting and different indeed there, Joe Hostentola. God, we get a lot of good comments on this. Jeez, oh, Carbon Vader doesn't work for me. Yeah, I kind of agree, although some people love it. Oh my God, the comments were just wild. Yoda's body is finally the right height, people are saying, but the head is, as you and I were talking last episode, a little bit weird. I like Blue Vader, I don't like Blue Vader. I like Blue Vader, I don't like Blue Vader going on, which is really interesting. Daniel Woodhouse says, that new Stormtrooper is as sexy as hell. Okay. Oh my God, Blue Vader, not Blue Vader. Yes, Blue Vader. Oh my goodness, these comments are nuts. Okay, these are some of the best comments I have read on one of our shows in a long time.
I was messaging you during the week saying
you were right. I thought, that won't be anything. Oh my goodness. Definitely check out the last show's comments. We'll put that in the show notes. There's some really fun comments in there, kind of people nitpicking each other in a nice way. So thank you everybody who commented. They're really interesting comments. So I'm going to go through and follow up with them properly. But Hasbro fan vote, again, at the time of this recording, is literally probably going to be coming off shortly. But Matt's fan vote is up. My fan vote is up. Go make your vote. Put them in both. Do it again the next day. The reason being is one thing that came up during my Q&A, certainly anyway, was that they made it really clear for all you haters and naysayers that they don't listen. They do. And straight from the horse's mouth was, if they see it on podcasts, if they see it on a forum, on an Instagram page, on a website, on a Twitter account, whatever it may be, they use that as a kind of boost to give management and others to say, the fans all really want this figure. So it is within your interest to comment under this video, comment in Matt's page, comment in my page, go to our Twitter pages, Facebook pages, and leave your, after the fan vote, but leave your thoughts about comments and figures. They do read them. So I do that
I'd as well. I'd also say, and vote, and even vote for, if you don't want to vote for Cody and you don't want to vote for Qui-Gon, but you want to vote for, I don't know, I'm making up now, I'm just saying it, a redone Poe Dameron pilot. It might not be a popular choice, but it might come in at number 9. And they will look at this vote as market research. They'll have their winner. They also have an answer on what the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, most desired figure is for the archive line. And we know that the archive line will keep going. Mm-hmm. So this is giving them the answers, not just about the winner. It's giving them the answers about wave 1, wave 2, wave 3, wave 4, wave 5, wave 6 from here kind of thing.
Yeah.
On what people want. And it would be stupid for them to come back and go, oh yeah, let's go and do Darth Vader's Return of the Jedi, what was that one? Emperor's Wrath. Mm. If nobody's voted for it, they're not going to put him into the archive line. So
for sure. Yeah.
They're going to go with the things that people are voting for.
I think, as you said a word then, I've forgotten what exactly you said that particular word, but I think you said ammo, but I think it gives them, again, directly from both Eric and Patrick, had said that there's a lot of characters they necessarily wouldn't make, but if they see enough votes and comments from people, we're talking about outside the vote as well, if they see lots of people talking about certain figures, like you and I talk all the time about Luke with the from the trash compactor scene, and we kind of got one, and there's certainly some indication that if they hear something and they've got enough of a weight behind it, or fans talking about it, they can use that to get that made. So it does give them this ammunition. So so yes, voting is absolutely valid. Do it. There'll be links to everything we talk about tonight, including our two fan votes, directly underneath the show notes. Again, voting will end shortly, but go and do it. Just before we get into the both of our Q&A and what was discussed, because it's a little long and hard to kind of break down easy, we had a couple of things go live. We talked about it in the last show. If you weren't aware already, again, there's links underneath the show, the YouTube show in the comments, and you can, sorry, the description you can see, but it's back again. Forlorm and Zuckuss has been up and down and up and down, but it is back to be ordered. The same goes for the Carby Vader. He is back to be ordered as well. They sold out, people really panicked, but nope, they're back. Their dates have been, as Matt pointed out to me earlier on tonight, some of the dates have been extended. You can see there as well, you've got Pan Carbonite and December 15th for that one coming out too. So skipping ahead into the Q&A very quickly, one thing that came out about these figures, actually raised by some others on the call with me, not by me, but they raised the question, and Patrick did say, without confirming too much, he said, essentially, there's going to be enough stock of these for other countries, for the UK, for Australia, for Canada, etc. So because it's a US exclusive, he's kind of hinted that there's going to be enough for other places. So wait for the exclusive to come out in, I think, as you've said before, EB Games, Canada, Toys R Us Canada, Zing in Australia, etc.
It could be Amazon.
Amazon, yeah, exactly. Amazon UK, Amazon Australia, Amazon Canada. Do they sell? Yeah, they do. Amazon Canada.
Yeah, well, we know that the UK has got a page. It's just not active.
Oh, is that right? Didn't know that.
Yeah, it's the where if you do that whole replace the country thing.
Oh shit! Yeah.
A1 turns up, but the Australia one says page not found.
Yeah. Okay. Let's change that. Go.uk. Let's see whether we get it. Spot on. Absolutely. Yep. So the page is available. So yes, it looks very likely, in fact, incredibly likely, you guys in the UK will be getting through Amazon. And they kind of did say this already before, so currently unavailable. So I guess what they're just working out is when, how much stock, and so you'll get a chance to buy it directly from the source, which is always good rather than scalpers. So there you go. That's good news. Nice one, Matt. How do we want to do? Do you want to go first to your Q&A, what your thoughts were, and maybe your questions?
Yeah, I can. No. And if you I'll kind of... Yeah, look, I had... When did we do it? Thursday night or Wednesday night? Wednesday night. Our Wednesday night, Tuesday... No, Wednesday morning, our Wednesday night. I don't know, however it works. Time zones. My time zone. So, look, my first question that I put out there was about San Diego Comic-Con being cancelled and the fact that every year there's a San Diego exclusive. Last year was Kenner Boba Fett. And last year was also the year that they took the Kenner Boba Fett on vintage 40th anniversary card back. San Diego Comic Con, then they took it to London, they took it to Mexico, they took it to Toronto, they took it to Italy, they took it to France. So they moved it around all the cons, and it's that idea of, with San Diego being cancelled, the easy solution is to put it out to Hasbro Pulse, but that's US centric only. And if the aim's been the last few years to get the cons out internationally and get the exclusives out internationally, are they going to address whatever the San Diego Comic-Con exclusive was on an international level rather than a Hasbro Pulse US exclusive kind of thing? And firstly, as they did on just about every question, they so nicely let us know that we haven't announced the San Diego Comic-Con exclusive. So we couldn't confirm that one is coming, but in that classic Hasbro way, it's also, but we've had one every year since we've been going. So it's a safe bet to think that there would be something. And yes, it would be a safe bet to think that it is our attitude of bringing things round to the whole world and out of, yeah. So we'll be taking it as managing it on time. If we know San Diego's cancelled, we'll see what happens with Celebration. We'll see what happens with London and Toronto and Mexico and stuff. But as, those either get cancelled or happen, they'll either be there if they happen, or if they get cancelled, they'll look to make sure that they get out internationally. So they are aware of this concept of not letting COVID just make it a a US-centric exclusive, which was great with, again, without any confirmation. It's a time will tell, and we need to see what the world we're living in 3 months, 4 months, 6 months is. So that was the first thing. Second thing was, again, I threw to them the idea of 6-inch playset dioramas and kind of talked about the modular playsets based on those 40th anniversary 2017 San Diego Comic-Con trash compactors, maybe the hallway of the Falcon or the, you know, the seats and all that without the big deck or the cockpit, whatever it is. It was that idea of, would you look at something like that? And they came back and basically said, it's something we'd consider. We can't really say the effort the team went into making those things. It was a passion project for more. They'd love to see things like that, but they're aware of this people's want of that kind of setup, but nothing to announce at this point in time or anything like that. So the other thing I put to everyone was, and we've spoken about it here as well, the idea of the missing wave. And that was, you know, I pointed out that Marvel Legends has always been so good in completing teams and finishing teams and, you know, what they've done with X-Men and all that stuff to complete Jim Lee's team. It's like, we're still missing Bodhi. We're still missing the third Scarif Shore Trooper. You know, what any chance that with the downtime of no movies until 2022 and Kenobi and Cassian Andor moving from 2020 to 2021 to 2022, is there an opportunity to use this COVID time to complete these missing characters and teams and complete teams kind of things? So that was taken on board, and we kind of got that talk that you just gave about the idea of, we see what people want, and you know, if we can justify it and this and that, and you know, we know that some teams are incomplete, but decisions have to be made and blah, 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 blah. Some people get more screen time than they were meant to, and some people turn out to be more popular than would be anticipated, and that wasn't the decision process. So, look, they're aware that there's holes in teams. So there was that. The other thing, the other question I was able to get in, I got four of my five in. The other one I was able to get in was to talk about HasLab, and from my point of view, it's the idea that HasLab is this once a year, and last year was an attempt at twice, but Cookie Monster didn't get up, but it's been the Sail Barge 2 years ago, Cookie Monster and Unicron last year, and let's just say Cookie Monster was a bizarre thing anyway, but it didn't get up. Unicron, they extended to try and make sure it got up, but these are $500 and $600 US projects. And it's like once a year. And I kind of put to what's come onto my page and my opinion as well, but that idea of more frequent HasLab projects at smaller scales. And I kind of got the feeling that the response was ultimately it's going to stay as the big, the big ticket item. And they're not, I don't think they're not interested in a smaller scale thing, but they still want HasLab to be
the big ticket.
It's never going to happen thing, and without it, and I don't know. I understand it, and I think it's good that they're keeping to that. In my reading of it, though, my personal reading is you've got what, 30 million unemployed Americans in Australia. We've got 4 million unemployed. You're kind of looking at a big ticket item being even more unachievable in the next 2 or 3 years than 2 years ago.
Yeah, that's definitely a point.
And it's just that thing of, you know, for me, for example, if they, if it's unlikely you're going to get a Dagobah Yoda hut kind of thing, and it costs $500 to make a Sail Barge in 375 with all that extra detail, it's like, if you could make $150 or $200 Yoda Dagobah hut in a reasonable size, a bit like the old 375 one in a 6-inch scale or whatever it is. Like, I mean, that's an achievable thing. I can part with $200, but I can't part with $500 or $600 at the moment.
That's a lot.
So that's where I was coming from. That kind of leads back to the 6-inch dioramas, but HasLab could be used to make a couple of those San Diego Comic-Con things. And, well, we need to make 5,000 of the Falcon cockpit. You'd make them and sell them, and it'd be great. And maybe retail needs 30,000 of them, and that's not achievable. But HasLab can do it from 5. So, but that got shot down. That's fine. They are continuing what they went out with, which was big ticket aircraft carrier kind of shit that's not going to turn up at Walmarts anymore kind of thing. So
sure.
that was that. And the thing that also came out of it for me across everyone's questions was basically, and you said it, they're reading comments. They're looking for feedback. And I've known from my page for years now that when we do polls, both official and when I was doing unofficial ones, I know the Hasbro guys were looking at it, and that sure. was one avenue where they were getting information from. And that'd be on my page, they'll be on your page, they'll be on forums and all that stuff. They'll be on everyone's pages watching comments and seeing things, and they pretty much reaffirm they are. And in saying that, I've kind of raised, not on in the questions, but separately, I've raised the thing of bringing back the hashtag I used to use, being hashtag Hasbro please.
Yep.
And that was really a couple of years ago, an opportunity for people to say, I really want a 501st clone trooper, Hasbro please. I really want the stormtrooper commander, Hasbro please. And you can share your post of what you want and Hasbro please it. And it's something that they'll look at least and see. And it's something that is one way to directly tell them what you want kind of thing, and mm-hmm. know that someone in the team is seeing it kind of thing. So otherwise, you know, they're saying they want to hear from us. There's no like make a request on a website scenario where they click data. So they're using social media to find that out. And that's one thing I'll do a post in the next week or so about, writing about this whole talk, and I'll put the Hasbro please tag back out there. And I've passed that tag back onto them because I'd passed it on to the old Hasbro team a few years back, and I'd have discussions with them about that, but I'd put it out there again. And for a couple of months, everyone can start saying what they want and let them use that. But the one thing they came out saying is, we want to know if you want to.
For sure. You know, I mean, why wouldn't you at the end of the day?
Gamorrean Guard is a perfect example.
Yeah, that's true.
And then you used to see them. You'd remember it, but like 3 years ago, there'd be just these little questions thrown out by Steve at an SDCC as he's doing Q&As with people. So would you pay more for a bigger figure? And those questions would be thrown out in other places. And they're just testing the market because everyone wanted a Gamorrean Guard, but he wasn't going to get made for $20. And once they had the answer from enough people saying, I'd pay $25-$30 for a Gamorrean Guard, then next thing you know, before Deluxe was even a numbered thing, a Gamorrean Guard shows up at a higher price point. It's like more plastic, more fur,
and a kind more of articulation. Yeah, yeah, so kind of army builder, you need probably a couple if you really want to, you know, do the completest thing and have a few in your Jabba's palace. But yeah, so what else did you have?
That was my four questions. And then, to be honest, the team of other pages I was with were really focused on the vintage collection. I kind of ended up in the vintage collection group. So, you know.
Well, you weren't alone. You weren't. I was the same. Victoria from Victoria's Cantina, lovely woman. James from Jedi News, Mark from Fantatrax, and an old buddy of mine, Tamer from the Imperial Shipyards, were all together. It's kind of fun for at the very beginning. We're all looking at each other's backgrounds and going, what toys have you got? And kind of looking at what was going on. It's kind of interesting. Look, I just want to say this for everyone who's watching anyway, because sometimes there's not a lot of people. We normally get quite nice people, but there are a lot of people, and you see a lot of comments on other sites like Hasbro suck, or you're a Hasbro apologist, or why did you guys get press boxes? There's a lot of people that just don't really know, I guess, how things have worked and why we do this and all this kind of stuff. But I want to boil it down very simply, and please agree or disagree. But Hasbro did not need to offer an interview slot for Matt and I. They did not need to waste the time given us an opportunity to speak to them. They didn't need to, you know, we gathered up the kind of thoughts of what you guys by osmosis tell us on shows and the comments and whatever it is. To pass that on. They didn't need to do any of that. And both Matt and I, if you've watched any of the 58 shows, we don't, you know, there's plenty of stuff we pick at Hasbro about price point, about not being good enough, about distribution sucking. So we're not a Hasbro apologist or sucking up to them. And a lot of the questions that people gave were quite hard. Mine weren't super hard because I didn't feel I needed to be. I'm really happy with the Black Series line. There's a few things that yes, we could change, but I think, as you'd probably agree with me, you kind of know the questions that Hasbro will, you're more likely to get an answer out of rather than saying, will you ever make a such and such figure? They just won't answer it. So you've kind of got to weave and dodge and find the cracks to answer the questions that they might give away. And so anyway, I managed to get four questions in. Pretty much everybody did it as well because time was tight. No surprise, my number one question was stands and kind of diorama parts. I know, broken record. But what I did would bring up a lot of the time was Dwight and the guys in the Marvel Legends team and the Black Widow figure recently, and how that stand flying poses, Captain Rex with a jetpack, Boba Fett with a jetpack, hell, jet troopers, Jedi flying through the air. You name it, there are characters who have the ability to be elevated. So a stand of some kind, I said, look, just chuck it in a deluxe pack. People will buy these things with stands. Every figure we all have comes with two pegs and no stands. So it'd be good to get something. And they did appreciate that. Clear stands, they knew about, they understood about. I guess one of the things that was a thread through my questions was, because I was principally like you, all about Black Series, was that they watch what the Marvel team are doing. Each one of the two teams sit opposite each other, and what one team is doing, they kind of, yeah, I think we're going to do that too. And they kind of, there's a lot of inter kind of swapping of stuff.
Well, you can see it. You can see it. The Marvel guys put the photo reel out, and it took about 8 months for photo reel then to hit Star Wars. So call them the guinea pigs or the test things, and it worked, and they found their pricing and that it was delivering and people liked it, and the results were there. So then it goes to Star Wars, and that's great. And then, you know, this, no doubt I'm backing that Star Wars beat Marvel to it, but Marvel announced it first, the pinless joints.
Yes.
Because it feels like some of those pinless joints figures are the Fox franchise, X-Men, and all that stuff, those Wolverines and stuff. And so it feels like that's happened since the Disney Fox merger, and you've seen the prototypes and everything else. But I think Dagobah Luke will hit market before those figures, which would suggest that pinless was pinless joints in the works in the Star Wars team. But that's where you can see we borrow from one and this and that, and we test and do all that stuff. So look, they kind of said the same thing with us, that they sit opposite each other and they share notes, and it makes sense for them to share notes. And look, Snake Eyes, as we've already said before, that Snake Eyes figure looks like it's using the best of Black Series, the best of Marvel, to then now make G.I. Joe the fully Hasbro-owned franchise kind of thing. But everything we've learned from these two has come together on Snake Eyes kind of thing.
It's really exciting times, I think, for 6-inch collectors. And 3.75, Maya, there's a lot coming for you guys too. And I collect 3.75-inch too. But there's plenty of voices. And they hear the 3.75 stuff very loud and clear. But 6 inch is where maybe potentially a little bit more of the sales are. But anyway, so stands, they know about the stands, they're aware of the stands. I think Eric's kind of fair point that he made as obviously the guy who's really trying to kind of design this and do this at a certain cost. He did mention that, you know, the tortilla stands, I was kind of like, yeah, they kind of suck. They're looking at other ways of doing it, and if they can, they will, but it's a tight, tight price point to do it. But they would generally have to be smaller than the bigger Black Widow one. So anyway, long story short, give feedback on your stands on this show and comments on Twitter and everywhere else you are, because if you want them, and it may only be me and a handful of stand freaks, but they're clearly listening and they clearly put them in the pack. So these things are happening. Put the question of army builders. Again, I talked about Dwight and the guys doing Marvel Mondays. I get the feeling they're going to do something, and it feels very much like it's coming. So something Mondays will be coming at some point. I think maybe we'll see how it goes. I mentioned Han Mud Trooper, bring it back, man. And lots of other things. And again, you, to your credit, Matt, you were always one that was always like, repack the Stormtrooper, because I know you love Stormtroopers, repack the Stormtrooper. So they get it, and they were talking about it, and they understood it. And there might be a chance of doing it, and it looks like it's on the cards. Something may be coming for that, so stay tuned. I also raised 12-inch figures. Marvel had a line of 12-inch figures, Spider-Man, Deadpool, Thor, Hulk, Wolverine, etc., Cap. I loved them. I thought they were really toyetic and really cool. They could have been a little better in terms of facial scan and other accessories, but I adored that line. I loved the scale. I kind of got a smile at Patrick's face that, you know, maybe, I don't know. I read it as I think they might have maybe tried prototypes, looked at it, watched what the Marvel team have done. Maybe have something to play around with. I don't know.
Can you imagine if they make a 12-inch, say a 12-inch Black Series scale, because I think they call the Marvel Legends one the 12-inch Marvel Legends scale. So they do the 12-inch one and they just go for it. And from the get-go, it's just like, we're making these 12-inch ones and they're in vintage boxes.
Oh my God. Like
those Kenner vintage boxes with the fold over.
Oh, kind of, boy. Well, that's exactly what I... That's exactly what I said to Patrick. Was the when I was a kid, one of the figures I got, and because there was no other good ones left, I got a Luke, and he was like a Barbie Ken doll, but it was actually quite a good figure with a good facial.
Bendable knees.
Yeah, bendable knees, and his little boots that he could take off, and then never get the frigging things back on. And he had a string little rope in for the grappling hook and
yellow lightsaber.
Yellow lightsaber.
Well, no, blue. Did he get the blue one and Obi-Wan got the yellow one?
Yellow one
was the blue one. And yeah, so it was bizarre because it was 12-inch Luke came with a blue lightsaber and 12-inch Obi-Wan came with a yellow lightsaber, yet the 375s were the other way around.
I think it was to do with
Obi had the blue and Luke had the yellow on the 375, but in the 12-inch it was the other way around because, you know, whatever. My parents had toy shops, so I had the Luke, I had the Han, I had the Chewie, I had the C-3PO, I had the R2, I had the Stormtrooper, I had the IG-88, I had the Boba Fett.
Yeah.
I didn't have the Jawa, and I didn't have Princess Leia. They were the two I didn't have in that 12-inch Kenner line.
Yeah. You're lucky you had that. They were really hard to come by where I was as a kid. But that's exactly the point I made to him, was the Kenner box with that fold on the kind of card. And I said, man, just make a Boba Fett. Just make a Boba Fett and a Stormtrooper. We're all going to buy it at 12-inch scale. And I may be overreading into Patrick's reaction, but I just felt it was a little bit of a wink of a smile and like, maybe. So you heard it here first if it happens. If it happens in 2 years' time, it'll be because, you know, not because of us.
Your Q&A.
We kind of found out first, put it that way. But I'd love a 12-inch link. Anyway. The last and final question was, and this relates to the first thing I was talking about, was I actually gave Hasbro some praise, and I genuinely, honestly think they did deserve it. And you and I spoke about this and agreed. they really tried over the last year to include Italy, London, Brazil, even Australia in the in the cons and the conventions and the reveals of the figure, the sales of the figures. We even saw an increase in exclusives for the figures, way more at retail. It's still far from perfect. And Patrick did say that he agreed and was grateful to get that nice feedback, because sometimes I don't think you get nice feedback. As fans, I think a lot of the times it's just, oh, you suck, you never made such and such, or the whatever figure. And they don't really get a lot of input of a positive nature, which is really unfair, because if we're buying all these figures, they must be doing something right. Anyway, I thought it was brilliant what they did, because I've never seen that in all the time I've collected. It was USA only, and the other countries get the scraps. But in the last 12, 24 months, it's been pretty good. Just as we showed, even the UK getting that figure there for hand carbonate. So they're really trying to improve it. They're definitely trying to improve retail connections overseas, outside the US, Canada, Australia, UK, Europe, with partners to try and get them to deliver more. We talked about more fan channels, BBTS, Dark Side Toys, etc., because they can ship globally. And he kind of, oh, okay, and nodded away about that. But he did say there's a lot that is going on behind the scenes about that globalizing exclusives, and making a US exclusive much more readily available and having the stock pre-made and pre-thought for other countries. And both a lot of the UK guys that were on the call raised that same point about figures, and that kind of got the same comment as well, that we know we're trying. And I think at least getting that piece of feedback saying what I was saying, I think you did a really good job of starting out on the globalization of news, etc., that keep going, don't give up, and they kind of like that. So all the other guys raised comments about vintage, pretty much, and some kind of questions that I thought were already answered, but they were done, and it was a nice bunch. And again, really grateful Hasbro even just gave us an opportunity to just ask them, because again, they could have just went nah and carried on. So you got to give them credit that they are listening. They will talk to people, to the press anyway. We're press, I guess. So it's kind of positive, but you know, there's not a lot they can say, I guess. You were saying, you know, we're saying the same thing. It's, they can't give away stuff. And I guess, as we'd said again in previous shows, as fun as it is to find out the leaks and the rumors, it was evident this year, or last year.
There was both New York Toy Fair and New York Comic Con were these letdowns, because everything spoiled the day before, 2 days before, 3 days before. It was like there was no new reveals, and the only people who got away with new reveals was Marvel, and that's because the stuff that leaked was only a drop in the ocean, because they weren't really revealing five figures, they were revealing 25 figures, kind of thing. And so, look, I think, as you say, it's fun to find out, it's fun to speculate, and people have gotten so good at it now, and it's impossible that if you want good distribution, that people aren't going to be able to spoil things, because there's mechanics and timelines and all that stuff to be met. But, you know, you've also got to respect their want to try and announce their product and try and be able to have a spectacle out of it, kind of thing. The only thing they can do to beat the leakers is to tell us about something instead of 6 months early, 8 months early. And then it might feel like they're taking too long to get, and then the comments will start being, it's getting long in the tooth.
Yeah,
or
exactly.
The only way they can beat the spoilers is by confirming earlier, but saying, we're letting you know now, and you're not going to be able to get it till January next year.
Yeah.
So you're damned if you do and damned if you don't. I think, speaking of timelines and all that, somebody else asked a question about Baby Yoda / the child. Don't upset people. It's the child. It's not Baby Yoda. It's like, it's not the child either. It'll have a name sooner or later. But the question was asked, like, you know, last week, the week before, and in the coming weeks, the Black Series Yoda figure is shipping out. in the process of shooting the first lot of stock. It was, what's the usual time for making and how long did it take for Baby Yoda? And we've known and talked about it. It's 12 to 18 months for selection, design, prototyping, sculpting, revealing, whatever, whatever, to shelf. So 12 to 18 months, 12 at its fastest, 18 months on its more expected times. They found out about Baby Yoda on the night that The Mandalorian went to air. They had a prototype turned around in 4 weeks and released to us all publicly. That first shot we had a look of Baby Yoda was 4 weeks from when they first designed it, sculpted and prototyped it. And it's hitting, it was shipping out in April. So we're talking about December, January, February, March, April, 5 month turnaround from development, design, prototype, reveal, orders, shipped. So it's the fastest figure they've ever done. Obviously it's a small figure and simple articulation and everything else, but that is still a huge turnaround. And that's essentially the same thing with every bit of Yoda, Baby Yoda merchandise. Everyone's turned it around for April, May, June kind of thing. And they all would have been breaking every single record they've ever had. And no doubt Lucasfilm was also giving approvals quicker than they've ever given before.
Sure, sure. No, I agree. It's, you're right. I mean, they've turned that product around really quick. And again, I guess sometimes it's like, even just the one thing that struck me was, is kind of vanilla is some of the answers they had to give. And you could see at times, more so Eric than Patrick, it was hard for them to answer some questions because again, it would spoil stuff and it would kind of, you know, they're obviously hearing and thinking, shit, we've already got that in the works, or damn, we can't. And they were trying to go around it. It's kind of like, I feel sometimes we're like a bunch of kids, like, daddy, daddy, tell me what I'm getting for my Christmas. And dad eventually gives in and tells you, and then Christmas Day, you're like, I know all about that. And you're disappointed because you don't know. It's, we're kind of really difficult to please fans. And I think we've got a lot of the blame to take on ourselves about, you know, when you see all this stuff about negativity about Hasbro or distribution or other issues, it's like, yeah, sometimes we're not very fair to them. We're a little bit uneven. And again, they were willing to give up 45 minutes of the time to sit and listen to a bunch of nerds twice, if not three sessions. Four sessions of nerds they had to put up with of us. That's probably with the same questions.
16,
oh my goodness. 16
to 20 sites.
So they probably, they had about 4 hours of, 4 hours of us asking the same questions. Where are we getting this figure? And why this sucks? And kind of, so, and I'm including me in that voice. So they're doing a lot better than I think we sometimes give them credit for. But I'm sure I'll get flack for seeing them apologize or something. But I thought it was very nice of them. I thought it was good of them to do it. And they answer the questions as much as they can. You and I know a little bit more rumors and stuff that goes on. And I think, again, we're all going to be very happy at what comes. But, yeah, it was still interesting. It was still worthwhile. And there's lots more to come. And we'll bring it to you on the 6N Show. What else do we have? We were going to wrap up, I think, with a little bit of... let's give it a shout anyway.
While you're doing that, I'm going to quickly thank Hasbro for my 40th anniversary box, because
both of us, yes
I sometimes get stuff and sometimes I don't, and very happy to get this one. I do everything they say. I gotta say, it was free and everything else, and I love it. I haven't actually done my photos yet or posted on. I'll do it this weekend. Mine turned up a little bit later. It had longer to fly out, so I didn't quite get it on May the 4th. But in there, as you'd know from everyone else's photos, there's some kind of like, call them diorama photos or set photos that you can, there's Dagobah, Hoth, and Bespin, Carbon Chamber, and all that stuff. And you can set up and use it as a backdrop, like people use their screens and everything, which is great. And again, this is catering to the toy photography community. It's catering to those who want shelf displays in a very cheap and effective way. And, you know, it's not going to market or anything, but it is that thing that they know that people want more kind of thing than just the figure. That was great. I also thought it was great. I shared them all, and maybe that's what we can look at after this, is that 10 photographers did Empire Strikes Back pics. I've shared them all on my page with Hasbro, in partnership with Hasbro. And what was really great to see from my point of view, and I'm sure from the photographer's point of view, was that other years they've done this, like the 40th anniversary of A New Hope, and a couple of other times they've done the Hasbro toy pick thing. It's been an Entertainment Weekly story, and that's great. Like, whatever, Entertainment Weekly, it's good, it's big, it's pulpy, it's commercial and everything else. But this year's one was a partnership with The Hollywood Reporter, which is just insane.
Yeah.
Those 10 photographers and their 10 pictures were all shared as a Hasbro teams with toy photographers for Empire Strikes Back 40th anniversary. And it's a story in The Hollywood Reporter about these 10 photographers and their pictures. And like, I mean, that's like, I don't know, coming from my own background, that's like real news versus magazine pulp kind of thing. And Entertainment Weekly is awesome, whatever. But it's very white bread versus like, this is the same place that confirms that Taika is going to be directing the next Star Wars film kind of thing. You know, they're the ones to break it. And, you know, and then now they're the ones sharing this story rather than the one who's telling it who Ben Affleck's dating or whatever.
Yeah.
So it was really good to see, but maybe that's what we can show now is those 10.
So if you just joined us, you'll catch up. But Instagram.com/StarWarsTheBlackSeries. We're just going to have a quick look tonight. But yes, let's share. And this is the page you want to follow. Because there's lots and lots of toy goodness. And it's coming up on screen now. There you go. So what we got? This is an unusual picture, by the way. This one here I just thought was really interesting.
Yeah, look, this is my, and I did it in time for this show. This is the TBSFF thing, the Black Series Feature Fridays, or Black Series Fan Features, or Friday Fan, whatever it is. I don't know what the FF stands for, but it's our hashtag, and you use that. I go through what is sometimes, and it was more this week, 1,000 pictures on a Friday night. Wow. And I just pick 9, I pick more than 9, and the ones that don't become a part of this sharing ends up pretty much being the rest of the weekend's picks. But I'll always look to feature new accounts on the first post of the 9 and whatever else, but it's just what I find interesting photos from the week. So this is where the 9 have ended, but if you count back, well, here you'll like this. You've got your middle shots. So you like other page, so they're all back shots.
Oh, I was going to say that. I get it now. Okay, nice. Next.
And it started with a behind the shot Denga. That was a first time feature for that page. So there's that. A Toy Store Near You is from the Toys Who Made Us guys. They're premiering that series on Amazon Prime and YouTube on the 29th of May, which is looking at, I think it's a toy store from each state. Kind of iconic collectible stores in each state. And it was meant to be about them. I think it's also now about the COVID. And that's impacted the stores and all that kind of stuff. And this series is about helping those stores now.
My eyes were immediately drawn to the OCP,
OCP
t-shirt and the goodies in the background. Sorry, continue.
So yeah, look, that's something to look out for. But if I'll actually share it again tomorrow so that when this is live and all that stuff, if you click into my stories, I've got a link to the trailer to this, which looks really great.
Nice. So yeah, just pick any other ones you wanted to highlight just with regards to what you were saying.
We'll scroll them all. If we scroll down to the May 4th shots, that's where the Hollywood Reporter /partnership shots were. Like, I mean, that Empire shot, if we just go back up, So many people have done that shot before, and that has to be one of the best ones.
It's beautiful.
And if you look at the behind the scenes, it's actually a staircase. It's not a digital... maybe I didn't share all the images. No, I didn't. It's on his original post. Maybe because it was video, and that causes problems sometimes.
Yep.
But yeah, it's one of the better ones. Lots of Clone War ones from that final two episodes.
Oh, so good. So again, that one there, I just noticed with the... Just going all the way back up. I mean, just beautifully done to reflect the final shot.
Yeah. And the blue lightsaber with the Darth.
Oh, Rene. This is stunning. This is so... Good God, it's so movie-like. Bleaner things, stunning job. This is great stuff. You gotta head over there, people. Star Wars, Instagram.com/StarWarsTheBlackSeries. It is always worth just... 'Tis toy photography porn is what it is. It's well worth a look.
So scroll down and then we'll go back up. So starting here, go back to, it starts with that layer shot. Go up, up more, and up one more. That Hoth saying, this is the Hollywood Reporter / Hasbro Pulse / toy photo community partnership.
Wow. Yeah. Isn't that fabulous how it just all got pulled together? I love that breakdown. So well done.
So that's by Jason Work More or Less.
You look.
And it's Luke and Darth. That's Black Series Zay. Swit Pits is the Yoda one. Who's that one?
This is plastic.
Action. Yep.
I love this. The running pose there. Looking good. I'll get a rope in the Falcon. That's just, yeah. Explosion! Sergeant Banana is always good. Empire Strikes Back, literally. It's some beauties. Oh, God, it makes me want to watch Empire now when I see this stuff.
So it ends with that Leia one, but they are the 10 that were... they were the 10 that were in the Hollywood Reporter, which I just thought was insane. Such a... big kind of outlet to cover it.
Beautiful. And more I see it, not even on your page sometimes, because you do share them, but on even on other pages, I'm seeing a lot of people share some incredible stuff. Yeah, these new horse troopers, I'm looking forward to getting mine. God, they look so good. So good. Yeah, such a good episode at the end of the Clone Wars. Very quickly, I do want to shout out to, and I was thinking of you when I got this photograph from him, but the photograph here by Todd Russell, I just thought was just awesome. I love that scene. He was telling me here today, I was like, how did you make this thing? And he let a couple of secrets go that it was. A lot of it was printed from kind of information they had. And then this actually had some water in it. He had a kind of a kitchen plastic tray utensil he built up around it, and got some other photographs he shared with me privately. But I think you and I just both loving this scene. And of course, it's our 6-inch show kind of logo, is the two of us in escaping from the Death Star gear. So anyway, that was that one. But yeah, it's making me want to watch The Empire Strikes Back now that I see all this stuff. What's going on here?
So Jason Work More or Less, actually, with the COVID thing, these mini colouring in books.
Nice.
He's an illustrator and designer as well, and he actually made these as downloadable so kids can colour in or adults can colour in, whatever, over the lockdown. And he then made and printed mini versions of it and had Luke doing it. But there are many versions of what he's actually done and put up on his website for download.
That's super. Well, what we're going to try and do is there's been a lot of Hasbro news, a lot of Hasbro reveals. We've had May the 4th. We've got a little mini moment of mild quietness. So what we're going to maybe try and do is in the next show is give you a lot more toy photography stuff, maybe a little competition as well. So we'll do a lot more and dive into some of the goodness that's happened in recent months and catch up a little bit more on the photography side of things, because we've had to cut it short in the last couple of shows. But anything else particularly you want to just shout out to?
No, I think that's probably it.
Well, we'll come back. We're going to come back and revisit some.
I think we can probably say that, you know, obviously Wave 1 and Wave 2 is hitting American stores of the 40th anniversary.
Yep.
Wave 1's definitely hitting Australian stores, be it Zing, Kmart and Big W here. But Wave 2's definitely hitting US stores randomly. Pretty much Walmarts and Targets, I think, from what I can tell off my page. They're popping up and I think that's about it. There's not really anything else.
Cool. Well, I remember the time the show was live, you probably can't, but anyway, vote.
What we should say though too is that our vote, we have to tally up by Monday New York time.
No,
what is it?
Friday night, New York time, midnight.
Oh, yeah, it cuts off, but we need to tally up our votes and report to them by Monday, I think.
Yes, correct. Yeah. Yes.
So we give them the tallies. Everyone gives them the tallies, and whether it's 5 or 10 or whatever it is, and whether it's on the Hasbro Pulse side or on the Star Wars side, where that'll all get announced, but there will be another vote. It's not going to be first past the post based on the fan votes. We're going to give those results to Hasbro, and either Star Wars or Hasbro will then host another voting segment. So Cody can win this one, for example, and there'll be 4 or 9 other contenders.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone will have the opportunity to look at and think about what they want from what the options are.
Sure.
So Cody might be first past the post here, but you might also have people who go, Han Solo, New Hope, or Qui-Gon, that's actually really good. And you might find, again, the people who don't want Cody might all start joining up on
the
photo real one, or they might just go hell for leather on Cody. But there's another round of this is what I'm trying to say. It's not over by whatever.
No,
Alva. We're just giving the options, and there's another vote to happen. And I guess I'd also point out, and I'll wrap this up really quickly. I've had one or two people on my page kind of go, you shouldn't be influencing votes, because I've been saying, and whether I influence or not, I don't really care at this point. It's my page. But that idea of, I will always say, vote for whoever you want. If you want to vote for Cody, vote for Cody. But I'm putting out there that I think it's best used on a photo reel thing. I think,
which is in there,
as we've already spoken today, that Hasbro know everyone wants Cody. We're going to get Cody. Cody is as sure a thing as when people used to say, you're going to get Ben Kenobi. It's like, yeah, but I want him now. I think there's a guarantee that Cody is in first 100%. Or second wave of the archive in the next life. And we were talking about that when they first announced the archive live. We were talking about, well, who would make it? And we said, well, this one and this one and this one. And of course, this is the opportunity to bring Cody back, kind of thing. Like, that was 2 years ago. So my thing is, I'm not influencing. I'm just trying to make people think about their vote.
Yeah, of course.
And I'm also pointing out the idea that if your vote is Cody without a helmet, it's not going to happen. And it's not going to be counted by me as Cody without a helmet. It's going to be voted as a Cody vote. And that means you're going to get Cody with a helmet, kind of thing. So, and then lastly, I just point out, when it's like, you should be impartial. It's like, my page is a fan site. And I'm a fan, and I'm sharing my opinion. And I'm also telling you, if you want to vote for Cody, vote for Cody. I'm not.
I, No, don't vote for Cody. You're absolutely right. I mean, it actually says it in the rules, of which I've copied exactly both of our pages of the same text. Fans can vote for any character that has been featured in the Hasbro Star Wars The Black Series line so far to be made as a refresh figure with a photoreal deco, if applicable. So they're kind of saying to you, yeah, we'll redo it with a photoreal deco because that's kind of what we're intending. But I guess they've obviously got the out saying, well, if applicable. But they're basically saying there's the point of they'll give you a figure that's updated rather than just a re-release, which, as you said, it will come.
So, it will. Like, I mean, the archive line, if you work it out, and I had this discussion with someone else on the page, there's about 5 human-faced figures in the leftover from the blue and the orange wave. And there's probably 5 or 6 human figures from The Force Awakens and The Last Jedi, maybe 10 at best, that could get redone. Although, you know, put it this way, I still think that one of the two reasons Jyn Erso and Cassian Andor were peg warmers was because their faces were so bad.
I agree.
You give a well-painted Jyn Erso face, people didn't dislike the character, and the figure's not bad. It's just that she looked a bit like a sex doll kind of thing, that translucent skin.
She did.
It was weird.
Not that we know what sex dolls look like, but yeah.
No, I've never seen an 80s comedy. but it's the opportunities there for even then people going, oh, Jyn Erso will just be another peg warmer. It's like, I guarantee you a repainted Jyn or a repainted Cassian will not be a peg warmer. Kind of thing. It's a peg warmer because no one wanted to buy those figures looking like that. It's not that they're the worst figures that were ever made and all that stuff. Cassian's an awesome figure.
But there was an awful lot of them made too, which was one of the problems. It was kind of overdone production run for those figures. So
So yeah, my just thing is vote for who you want, but there is an opportunity with these votes. And more importantly, now that we'll probably be sharing this for after the vote's done, there's an opportunity when the final figures are revealed to vote with that in mind. And that's what I'm pushing. And if people want to get upset with that, get upset with it. But at the end of the day, I'm a fan site. I'm pushing a fan opinion, just like anyone who wants Cody and pushes it on their page.
Sure.
Wants Cody. It's like, you know, anyway, that's that. And that's the vote. And I've said enough. I said I didn't want to say anything else.
No, you're absolutely right. And again, again, as Hasbro have kind of said there, they're kind of giving you the opportunity to get a photoreal face. So why wouldn't you take that over just a straight re-release, which is more likely to come? So, and I had a few arguments as well with people who just still, and I think I said this in the last show, they were like, who cares? They know the figures and they're just going to make them anyway. No, the whole point is if there's enough votes for, I don't know, Slave Leia, she's got, again, just as they've told us straight from the horse's mouth tonight, if they have enough volume of comments, critiques, comments in a video, comments on Instagram, whatever it may be, of these kind of things, they can give that to senior management to validate the choice of making the figure. So it can bring figures that were otherwise languishing in their minds, maybe number 40, up to number 10. So it is not a wasted thing to get in a fan vote. Otherwise, they wouldn't ask for a fan vote. They would just not bother.
Just release it.
Just release it. No, don't give a shit the fans anyway, but they're asking.
No interest in releasing figure number 50 just because they wanted to, if nobody wants to buy it.
Yeah. I think it's more than ever, I think I've realized it's it really can make a difference. I think in the past, particularly for 3.75, there was a lot of EU fans kind of spoiled it and ruined it just with figures that just, it wasn't a true vote. It was a kind of, a scam job, I think, but there we go.
Jaina Solo was a scam job. I don't care what any.
Yeah, there was a lot of that nonsense that went along, wasn't there? Anyway, this seems to be much not like that. And again, because there's a limited kind of thing, we're not getting, you know, Waro's cousin or some freaking thing we don't know about.
It's much more pleasant. It's been the most pleasant fan vote to host.
Yeah.
From the outset.
But I'm just looking through literally thousands on both of ours. Thank you to everybody who voted. You're making a difference, but my God, Cody is just like huge.
Check mine out. Cody's there, but man, Slave Leia is...
Slave Leia. Greedo's not getting enough mentions, man. He's in there, but he's just not... I just know what it's
like. I don't think the majority. I think the thing with Greedo is, for those who have been collecting the whole time, they've got it and they love him. Yeah. For those who weren't collecting at the time, they don't know how good that figure is. They don't know what they're missing. And Greedo has never been cool. But that figure makes Greedo cool. Mm. If you haven't seen it because you weren't collecting in 2013, Greedo's a kind of shit character. Like,
he is. Great figure, but kind of shit.
Figure makes him one of the best early figures, and he still stands up to the best of today. But people just dismiss Greedo for whatever reason, but that figure is outstanding, and that figure makes him cool, just like Battlefront makes Greedo cool. Battlefront 2, I can't remember. I think it's Battlefront made Greedo cool.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I'm just quick looking. You're kind of Cody. You're kind of Slave Leia. Cody and Slave Leia. Yeah. Cody's going to be up there. Put it that way. That's for sure.
Cody's going to be number one as far as fan votes go. But let's see what happens when you merge them all together. And you've
got it. We're gonna have a pile.
Choose votes. From five or choose from 10 or whatever it is. If they're smart, they'll do it from 10 because then it gives them two waves worth of research.
Yep. Wow. Okie doke. I think that's us. Thank you for voting. Thank you for your listening to us about the questions and fan votes. Stay tuned. You get some great stuff from Hasbro coming up from what we know. It's going to be fab. It's going to be really good. So hang in there, and we'll be back with another show, a bit more toy photography, maybe a little giveaway. We're working on it. And let us know what you think of the show in the comments below. If you like it, give it a thumbsy uppy, and we'll see you for more stuff from the 6-Inch Show.
Bye.